No army had ever carried war so far. They conquered an empire from the Persian Gulf to the Mediterranean Sea. They despoiled the great city of Babylon and enslaved the tribes of Israel. Even the Pharaoh of Egypt paid them tribute. Their army became the largest yet seen, their warriors the greatest, and their warfare the cruelest. In September of 655 BC, an Assyrian army sets off from its base in southern Iraq. Its target, Elam, a kingdom on the Persian Gulf. Boldly, the Elamites march from their city, cross the river that divides them from their foe, and prepare to do battle. At daybreak, the first Assyrians come into view. Like a storm gathering, thousands of horses and men assemble. The signal for attack is sounded, and the chariots charge. By day's end, the river runs red with the blood of animals and men. The blood of Elamites. In their hour of victory, the Assyrians are proud and cruel.
I cut their throats like lambs. I cut off their precious lives as one cuts a string. Like the many waters of a storm, I made the contents of their gullets and entrails run down upon the wide earth. My prancing steeds plunged into the streams of blood and filth. With the bodies of their warriors, I filled the plain like grass.
Among the victims, the Elamite king.
Tumen, king of Elam, fled to save his life and hid in a wood. The crossbar of his royal transport broke and it overturned on him. In desperation, he said to his son, "Use your bow."
Tumen's son tried to save him, to no avail. The king was caught and beheaded. The trophy was taken to the Assyrian king, who slashed it and spat on it. Then he hung it on a tree for all to see, while he celebrated his victory with a banquet. Tumen's followers suffered no less. Some were made to grind up the bones of their dead. Others were flayed alive. When the Assyrian king returned to Nineveh, his artisans immortalized the triumphs of his war machine. In room after room of his cavernous palace, they glorified his butchery. Men impaled on spikes, eyes put out, heads cut off. To ambassadors from distant realms, the writing on the wall was clear. The great Assyrian army arose from humble origins, a small state surrounding the holy city of Asshur, from which they drew their name. Well situated in the rain belt of what would become northern Iraq, Assyria grew up on the fertile banks of the river Tigris, a kingdom as prosperous as the land. But these plains, so inviting to be tilled, beckoned to be plundered. In one hand, a farmer needed his plowshare. In the other, a sword. By 1000 BC, Assyria, long a vassal to other kings, had tired of the foreign yoke. As regent of the gods on earth, the king of Assyria was divinely sanctioned to wage war.
Ashur, father of the gods, empowered me to depopulate and repopulate, to make broad the boundary of the land of Assyria.
Assyria began to enlarge its borders, but with each change of seasons, the empire withered. When autumn came, soldiers returned to their fields, and rebellion sprouted. In 745 BC, a new king took the throne and changed history. Tiglath-Pileser III vowed to make Assyria forever strong with a standing army. Encouraged by the prospects of a career in arms, thousands of young men enlisted. Tiglath-Pileser created all the institutions these soldiers would need, starting with an armory.
To provide proper arrangements for the camp, to look after the steeds, the mules, the chariots, the battle equipment, and the enemy booty.
Iron was the backbone of the army. Each soldier was issued a conical iron helmet, a sturdy breastplate of interlocking strips of bronze, and strong leather boots. The tallest men served as spear carriers, wielding an iron-tipped lance. When they locked with their foe, they would reach for their dagger. Some soldiers became archers. Some carried no weapon at all. Their role was to protect other warriors. They gave cover to archers with shields 4 feet high, hammered out of leather, faced with bronze, or plated with wickerwork. At the festival of the new year, the king inspected his army to ensure it was always ready to fight. Fed, clothed, and armed at his expense, the Assyrian warriors became the most professional army the world had yet seen. Well-equipped as they were, the Assyrians sought more: horses for their chariots, iron for weapons, timber for siege engines. To acquire these tools of war, the Assyrians campaigned farther and farther afield and brought back the spoils of victory.
Gold, silver, tin, copper, linen garments with many splendid trimmings, large and small monkeys, ivory, ebony. This, their tribute, I received, and they embraced my feet.
From his throne in Nineveh, the king knew where the peace was kept and where it was broken. Messengers relayed signals from fire towers or wrote dispatches on clay tablets. In 701 BC, the Assyrian king Sennacherib received troubling word from the province of Judah. Its king refused to pay tribute. Sennacherib was furious. He mobilized his army, tens of thousands strong, then swelled its ranks from states who owed him allegiance.
Get together your prefects and the horses of your cavalry immediately. Whoever is late will be impaled in the middle of his house.
Before the Assyrians set off, priests sacrificed bulls and goats, and the troops prayed to Ishtar, goddess of war.
O thou, heroine among the gods, like a bundle, rip him open in the midst of battle. Raise up against him a tempest, an evil wind.
At the outset, the Assyrians enjoyed an advantage possessed by few enemies, mobility. They would travel along good roads, maintained by the shovels of prisoners of war. On flat land, they could advance 20 miles a day. The king rode at the front among his cavalry and chariots, followed by his infantry. Behind them all snaked a long supply train where craftsmen made weapons as they rode. In surmounting natural obstacles, especially rivers, the Assyrians reached new heights of ingenuity. Vehicles were carried in large boats, horses swimming behind, troops crossing on inflated animal skins, shields and weapons strapped to their backs. Living off the land, such a host would not have gone far. Because the king had set up huge granaries throughout the empire, his troops could campaign up to 300 miles from a base of supply. Truly could the king of Assyria make his power felt far and wide. Without such supplies, they could not feed the herds of horses so vital to the Assyrian army, whose most feared weapon was the chariot. Like the Egyptians, the Assyrians had improved on the clumsy four-wheeled carts of Babylonia. Massing their two-wheeled chariots like shock troops, they broke an enemy's line and showered it with arrows and spears. Into this chaos, the cavalry, waiting on the flanks, charged. Whoever fled was run down. Whoever remained was picked off by archers and spearmen. But the Assyrians avoided shooting horses. So important were they that the king appointed officials to oversee their capture, mostly taken from northern Iran. As the supply of horses increased, the Assyrians developed a new weapon, as valuable as the chariot, the horseman. At first, he was merely a cheaper version of the charioteer, two men manning two horses. One steered and held a shield, while the other used his bow. Soon, the mounted warrior came into his own. Mobility matched with speed, matched with firepower. Against such a foe, the Judean king Hezekiah dared not risk battle. He retreated within his capital, Jerusalem. All over Judah, his subjects fled to their own towns. Their narrow streets overshadowed by high walls up to 20 feet thick. To withstand the siege that would surely come, Hezekiah dug an underground channel to bring water into Jerusalem. Where the Assyrians could not send their army, they dispatched terror. At Jerusalem, a high Assyrian official strode up to the walls. He spoke not to the king and his Jewish commanders in the language of diplomacy, but to the defenders on the battlements in their native Hebrew.
I am talking to the people on the wall, who will have to eat their excrement and drink their urine. Hezekiah cannot save you. And do not let him persuade you to rely on the Lord. The emperor of Assyria commands you to surrender.
While he delivered this threat, the promise of doom was being fulfilled 30 miles to the south at the town of Lachish. Built astride the trade route to Egypt, Lachish was as strong as it was rich. Behind its steep slopes and high walls, its defenders were confident of holding out. Just as confident, the Assyrians set up their camp behind an oval wall with defensive towers and set about building siege engines. The wooden walls would protect the soldiers inside as they manned an iron battering ram. With it, they would pound the weakest point in the city's walls. Lachish's weak point was its gates. To approach them, the Assyrians first had to erect earthen ramparts covered with timber. Over these, the siege engines were slowly wheeled. The king marshaled his forces. Stone slingers at the rear, then the archers protected by their tall shields. At the very front, the spear carriers who would storm the walls. Together, they advanced, safe behind their huge siege engines. The engines themselves, vulnerable to burning arrows, were protected by leather sheets. A soldier holding a huge ladle would douse any fire that broke out. Below, sappers using iron and bronze tools began to undermine the walls. Above, other soldiers mounted ladders to scale them. No army had so perfected the art of siege. Such an onslaught could not be withstood. When finally the walls were breached, the Assyrians rushed in, shielded by Ishtar, goddess of war.
Thy face shall not turn green, thy feet shall not tire, thy strength shall not fail thee in the heat of battle.
Ishtar spoke the truth, but the carnage was unspeakable. The ringleaders of the rebellion were impaled on stakes outside the city, their limp bodies a warning to other Judeans still holding out. King Sennacherib rewarded his soldiers with their share of quivers, daggers, bows, furniture, and goblets. Not all tasted the fruits of victory. At Lachish, 1,500 Assyrians, overlooked by Ishtar, would lie together in a mass grave. Meanwhile, King Sennacherib made good his losses and counted his spoils.
200,000 people, great and small, male and female. Horses, mules, camels, asses, cattle and sheep, without number.
In Judah, as elsewhere, the Assyrians made sure the spirit of the conquered was indeed broken. They uprooted their subjects by the hundreds of thousands and carried them off into bondage in Assyria. The Bible records that in 721 BC, 30,000 inhabitants of Samaria were thus deported. The Lost Tribes of Israel.
As for Hezekiah, the Jew, who did not submit to my yoke, 46 of his strong cities, as well as the small cities in their neighborhood, which were without number, by leveling with battering rams and by bringing up siege engines, I did take.
In the 50 years after the subjugation of Judah, Assyria pushed its borders to their farthest. In 675 BC, its warriors marched more than 1,000 miles and conquered Egypt. Assyria had reached its most glorious height. In its cities, peopled by merchants, craftsmen, artists, and scholars, civilization flourished as it never had. But the Assyrians had overreached. The empire now spanned the whole of the Middle East. Instead of governing its subjects, Assyria terrorized them. The conquered nursed their grudges and bided their time. In 612 BC, Assyria's greatest enemies united and marched on Nineveh. The great city was sacked. A society 1,000 years old collapsed, and its empire vanished. Fittingly, Assyria would suffer yet one more outrage. Its epitaph would be written by one of its own victims, the prophet Nahum.
All who hear the news of your destruction clap their hands for joy. Did no one escape your endless cruelty?
From the day these warriors fought, war would never be the same. They would march farther than any soldiers before them and outfight every army they met. In one afternoon, they would defeat the proudest civilization of their day. Led by the greatest general in history, they would forge an empire larger than any yet seen and leave their footprints forever on the world. The mists of dawn lifted on an autumn day in 338 BC. The pride of ancient Greece was challenged by an upstart from the north. King Philip of Macedon had come to fulfill a bold dream, uniting the Greek city-states by force. of these states stood together against him, Thebes and Athens. Among the Macedonians preparing to do battle was a young officer named Kenas. From this day, he would journey to glory undreamed of and lands unheard of. King Philip sat uneasy on his throne. Macedonia, a rural land to the north of Greece, was as fractious as it was rugged. The loyalty of the peasants extended no further than their lord. By marriage, diplomacy, bribery, and force, Philip molded a nation. Eyeing Greece, he dreamed of empire. As the Macedonians outgrew their land, young men followed a route to a better life, service in the king's army. Rich and poor enlisted with high expectations. They would not be disappointed. Coming from martial stock, Kenas was destined to serve his king. His father had estates and influence, and so Kenas entered the army as an officer. But he was drilled as relentlessly as any recruit.
Having reformed the military formations to give them greater strength and equipped them with suitable weapons, the king was constantly parading and training them for combat.
As a youth, Philip had been a captive of Thebes and a student of its army. Like the Greeks, he equipped his soldiers with pikes and formed them in a phalanx, a solid body of shields and spears. Philip had learned not only the Greeks' strengths, but their weaknesses. Unlike their army or any other, his would wage war year-round. He would give his enemy no time to prepare or recover.
I need not mention that he makes no distinction between summer and winter, that he has no stated season of repose.
In the summer of 339 BC, Philip led his men south, toward the Greek heartland. Their very march was revolutionary. Philip banned the trains of wagons that slowed an army. Each infantryman carried his own weapons and mess kit.
Any location sufficed for their camp. Any food for their provisions.
As the invaders approached, farmers hid their crops and their livestock to little avail. Lightly equipped, moving fast, the Macedonians lived off the land. Even on campaign, they honed their skills. By day, archers, slingers, and javelin throwers perfected their aim. night fell, they prepared to rub salt into the wounds they would inflict by carving taunts in their missiles. Before Philip, Macedonian warfare had been the preserve of nobles riding small ponies in wild charges. Philip would drill his cavalry as rigorously as his infantry and train them to ride in a wedge-like formation as formidable as the phalanx. Striking the enemy line at its weakest point, his horsemen would drive it apart. It was another revolution in warfare. At a place called Chaeronea, Philip's army found their way barred by more than 30,000 Greeks. They wore heavy bronze armor and advanced with their short spears held at the shoulder. When they locked in combat, they would thrust at Philip's men from behind their wall of shields. Macedonians under Kinas had a singular advantage, a sarissa, a pike up to 20 feet long, held underarm and tipped with a foot-long blade. Row upon row, bristling with pikes, this was the Macedonian phalanx.
Each man of the first rank was the points of five pikes extending beyond him. Those further back than the fifth rank hold theirs, slanting over the shoulders of those in front, so as to protect the whole formation. Keeping off by this serried mass of pikes, all missiles.
The first and last ranks wore heavy breastplates. The troops within the phalanx, needing only a light shield, were relieved of the burden of armor. And Philip was relieved of its cost. Thus could he field such a large army. So long as its lines remained unbroken, this forest of pikes could not be penetrated. It was the job of the phalanx to punch a hole in the enemy line. Then the companions, the elite Macedonian cavalry, would drive their wedge through it. Philip now deployed his infantry, 30,000 men. 2,000 horsemen under his teenage son Alexander waited for their opening.
Horses and men, gleaming not with gold, not with multicolored clothes, but with iron and bronze.
Thousand men advanced across the plain.
The blood really flowed, for the two lines were so closely interlocked that they were striking each other's weapons with their own and driving their blades into their opponents' faces. It was now impossible for the timid and the cowardly to remain inactive. Foot against foot, they were virtually engaging in single combat, standing in the same spot until they could make further room for themselves by winning the fight. Only by bringing down his opponent could each man advance.
Thrusting at the Greeks with their sarissae, Kinas and his comrades pushed and heaved in a great shoving match. At the height of the battle, Philip signaled his right flank to steadily fall back.
general cried out, "We've got to keep attacking until we push the enemy back to Macedonia." Philip remarked, "The Greeks don't know how to win."
On the Macedonians' right, the men kept pulling back. Sensing victory, the Greeks surged forward. What looked like retreat was a well-rehearsed trap. Greeks charged, their lines split. The Macedonian cavalry, led by Prince Alexander, struck at the gap. The whole Greek line buckled and broke. Vulnerable without their phalanx, they were run down by Philip's horsemen. The Greek army was destroyed. A lion would mark the graves of the Theban Sacred Band, an elite unit wiped out by Macedonians in a few hours. Celebrating their victory, Cinis and his men wallowed in an orgy of drinking.
They paraded through the midst of the captives, jeering all the time at the misfortune of the luckless men.
That night on the field, Cinis lay exhausted. Yet this battle for Greece was but the prelude to a harder campaign against a greater foe. Not long after the Battle of Chaeronea, King Philip was murdered. At age 20, his son Alexander took up his father's sword and his dream, the conquest of their ancient enemy, Persia. With the new king came new prospects for Cinis. Marrying the daughter of a general, he won command of his own regiment. Now he would help prepare the campaign against Persia. It was a land that could be as hostile as its army. Ingenious at adaptation, the Macedonians made boats from leather tents to ford rivers. They marched at night to avoid the desert sun. In the first year of the campaign, the newly wed Cinis was permitted to return home to see his wife. Gradually, the war took him ever farther from Macedonia. No obstacle halted Alexander's army. City after city fell. Persians deserted and swelled the ranks of the victorious Macedonians. Then this unstoppable force came to an object that would not yield. The city of Tyre. Built half a mile off the coast of what would become Lebanon, Tyre was an island fortress with walls 150 feet high. Its resistance would test the Macedonians to the limit. Since the Persians would not come to him, Alexander would go to the Persians. His engineers embarked on an unprecedented feat. A causeway 220 feet wide extending to the fortress. Kenas's men cut trees on the slopes nearby and drove two rows of trunks into the channel. Between the rows, they piled huge stones. As the Macedonians advanced toward the island, the Tyrians poured down a constant hail of rocks, arrows, and hot sand. Armor might deflect arrows, but the sand worked its way through. It was so painful that men dove into the water for relief, only to drown under the weight of their armor. Alexander's engineers erected two towers as high as the walls of Tyre, covered in animal hides. From atop them, Kenas directed his troops to return fire and clear the battlements. Ever improvising, the Macedonians built weapons of artillery whose tension was provided by strips of twisted leather. The Tyrians sent a fireship against the Macedonian towers and set them ablaze. Hundreds of men perished, but the siege went on. When they finally reached the walls, galleys with iron rams battered an opening. Kenas and his men stormed the city. The slaughter was savage. After 6 months of siege, the Macedonians showed no mercy. More than 8,000 Tyrians were executed. The rest, 30,000 people, were sold into slavery. Persia fell. Still, the Macedonians pushed ever eastward. Finally, in India, drenched by monsoons, 8 years and 3,000 miles from Macedonia, they could go no farther. They had had enough. One man plucked up the courage to speak. Kenas.
Sir, I do not propose to speak as an officer, but for the common soldier. My age, the repute which by your favor I enjoy amongst my comrades, and the unhesitating courage I have displayed in all danger and difficulties, give me the right to declare what I believe the soundest policy. Only a few from that great army are left. A small remnant, broken in health, their old vigor and determination gone. Every man of them longs to see his parents again, if they still survive, or his wife, or his children. All are yearning for the familiar earth of home, hoping pardonably enough to live to revisit it, no longer in poverty and obscurity, but famous and enriched by the treasure you have enabled them to win. Sir, if there is one thing above all others a successful man should know, it is when to stop.
Keenus was cheered by his men. The tide had turned against endless conquest. Grudgingly, Alexander relented. The Macedonians turned for home. In time, a new army from a younger empire would sweep over Macedonia, the Romans. But even they stood in awe of the Macedonians. A Roman general who fought them never forgot.
He later often confessed to his friends at Rome that he had never seen anything more alarming and terrifying than the Macedonian phalanx.
In the service of Alexander, Keenus had helped mold the largest empire the world had yet seen and the greatest army. He himself had risen far through the ranks and traveled farther than any soldier before him. He never saw his home again. On the way back to Macedonia, he, like Alexander, died. Befitting his rank, he was cremated with all the ceremony possible in an alien land.